Okay, here's something a little bit different for today's video. So if you've got a stitching pony like this, which you should have if you're doing hand stitching, if you're hand stitching without one of these, you do need to use one of these for consistency. These are quite good for gripping small items. So if you've got something, you know, like a knife sheath or something like that that's not too big, that's fairly sturdy, then it grips it quite well. It holds it in place while you do your stitching. Where I struggle with these is if you're doing bigger items, so you're stitching something like a bag or something like that, or you're stitching something that's quite floppy. So if you've got some leather that tends to flop about, or you've got two bits of leather and one of them tends to flop about, then that can be quite difficult. And the reason is that it only grips, you know, kind of 2 or 3 inches of the item. So if it's a big long item, you're gripping a little bit in the middle and the sides are all trying to flop about and things. You're also limited on a stitching pony by the throat size. Now, although it's quite generous, if you're stitching something like a bag that's obviously, you know, might be 4 times the length of this, it doesn't fit in here. If you use a pair of saddler's clams where you rest them on the floor, then obviously you gain that increase throat depth for getting something inside, but it still only grips the little bit of at the top. So what I'm going to do today is a little bit of an experiment. I'm going to try and make a kind of modification for this to help with stitching awkward items. And if it works, then it's something that you might want to try yourself. So I've already cut some pieces of wood. Now these are all cut from the same piece of wood here, and I don't think the size matters too much, but I'll tell you what size this is just in case you're wanting to get a reference on that. So it's sort of 45mm by 8mm, yeah, about 45 by 8, but it's basically, you know, a reasonably thin strip wood. It doesn't need to be anything too chunky, because it'll just want to fall off, but it also doesn't want to be too thin because it needs to be strong enough to hold the items. So I've cut 2 pieces which are going to be the jaws, and I've cut those to about 36 centimeters long, and again, that doesn't need to be exact, but what's going to happen is these will form the kind of jaws of the thing. So by the time we've put them together and joined them at the end and so on, there's only going to be so much depth. So again, it will depend on what you wanted to stitch. Now this is a bit of an experiment, as I say. If I find this is too short, I can always make another one later on. So 2 pieces at 36. I've cut 1 piece which is square, so that should be 45-ish by 45. That piece is just going to basically go on the back of one of these sides, and that's going to give me something extra to screw into, because I need to make sure that I make this quite strong, and there's not very much to get the screw into. So that's just a backer piece for there. So that would go like that. And then this piece here is 9.5 centimeters. And again, these are fairly arbitrary lengths. They're just what it looked about the right size. This piece is gonna go again on one of the sides at an angle like that. It's gonna also give me some extra to screw into, and then it's gonna stick down like that. And when this goes together, that is going to be what I can put into the existing pony, grip it at the top, and then that's going to give this right angle. So when this goes together, that piece will be at that side, that piece will be at that side, and that will form the jaws in that fashion there. And then we're going to put a hinge in the middle here so that this can open up like this. So the first thing to do is to actually wrap the leather around the inside faces of these, so we don't damage any items that we put in there or mark them. And it's going to be easiest to do that now before I start to put the rest of it together, so we'll do that a bit first. So the leather that I'm going to use to wrap the jaws is this natural pigskin. Pigskin's good for this job because it's tough, it's not expensive, there's no point putting really expensive leather on something like this, and it also molds quite well. You know, it's fairly supple, and so it will wrap around these well. If you do put any leather lining on the jaws of any of your clams or ponies or anything, I would suggest that you use a natural leather without any dyeing, and then you minimize, you should eliminate the risk of any color coming off it. So what you don't want to do is think, oh, I've got this scrap of black leather, I'll put that on the jaws of my thing, you grip a light coloured item and put a kind of black line on it. It shouldn't happen really, but it could do. So I would stick to using any natural coloured leather for doing that kind of a job. So what we need is enough leather to wrap around. Now there's no point wrapping the end bit because we're going to have to stick this together. So I need enough leather to come from kind of here to here. It's going to come up the full face on the inside, wrap around the top, and then it just needs to come a little way down the back and get that glued together. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut a couple of pieces and then we'll go glue them outside because it's going to be quite a lot of glue and it's going to be quite a strong smell. So go do that in the shed. Okay, back inside. I've made a slight mistake on those already. Doesn't really matter because it's only an experiment, but I should have kind of done one the other way around, so the leather goes around the top of one and underneath the bottom of the other, but it doesn't matter because as long as it's on the inside face, it's just to stop the wood marking anything. So but if you were to do it yourself, obviously the leather should go around the top of both pieces really. Okay, so I can trim the excess off the end. Okay, so that'll neaten the ends up there. So we've got two leather covered inside faces. We've got a bit at the end here where we're going to attach the other wood, and then they're going to come together like that. So what we can do now is we can fix these other pieces on. So we've got the small square and the piece to grab to there. So these are going to be stuck to the outside because the hinge is going to be on the inside. And it doesn't really matter which piece goes on which side, I don't think. Mark that. Okay, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to glue these first just to make it nice and strong, and then I can put the hinge on once the glue's dried. So I'm just using a little bit of normal wood glue. Okay, so I put the glue on. Now wood glue's not like leather glue where you need to leave it for ages. In fact, once it's on, you should just crack on and get sticking with it really. So push those together. I want to line this up nice and square, just for neatness as much as anything. So once I've done that, I'm also then just going to clamp. I could do with a smaller clamp really, but I'm just going to clamp those together while it dries and just double check that it feels lined up in the clamp. Just wipe any excess glue that might squeeze out of the joint there. Okay, so that's the first side there, so I'm going to pop that to one side to dry. And then we'll do the same with this side. And when I'm sticking this small piece on, I'm sticking it so that the grain goes one way here, so the grain runs this way in the wood, and then down the other way, just to try and give that a little bit of extra strength, because we are screwing into this. It's going to be more likely to split if all the grain runs one way, but it shouldn't split anyway, it's just for a little bit of extra strength. Check that that feels nicely lined up. And again, we can then leave that to dry. And then we'll come back and we'll put the hinge in, fix these two bits together. So the next thing we want to do is try and put this hinge in the middle here, so we can open it up and pop things in and then clamp it closed. So it's the same action as a, you know, a normal stitching pony, but essentially lengthways like that. And rather than relying on some flex in the wood, we're gonna use the hinge to do that. So this is just a normal hinge that I've bought from the shop, and what we need to do is pop this in here. I've tried to get one to sort of size to the wood, you know, to make it as strong as it can be. So because of the distance there on the hinge, that's going to naturally force the pieces of wood apart a little bit like that. So there's going to be a gap in there. Now, if you're gripping something that's obviously quite long, what you don't want is it really far apart. So if it was more like this, so that was spread really far apart, then you'd actually only be grabbing just where the pieces come together there, and that wouldn't give you a very strong grip, if you like. So what I've done is I've tried to make sure that the hinge is probably about the thickness of the things that I'm going to be putting in, and then that way, when this is all joined together and we put some clamps on there, then what we do is we get grip all the way down, or most of the way down, to make it nice and secure. What we want to do is put the hinge on there, and then the kind of knuckle bit of the hinge at the back, we need to make sure that that's not riding up onto there. So we just feel where it drops down and sits at the back. Make sure that it's nice and square to the edge, and then I'm just going to mark where these holes are going to be. And then I'm just going to go pilot drill those holes slightly before we screw in, only because this is quite soft wood and don't want to split the wood out. So I'm just going to put a little small pilot hole in the middle of each of those marks there. Okay, there's my pilot holes. It's only a little drill bit, so it's just to stop it splitting out. So I'll reposition this now, and then we can just screw this down. Okay, the screws that I've got are ever so slightly longer than the piece of wood, but the next size screw down that I've got is not quite really as robust as those. So what I'll do is I'll actually just file those points off when I finish this in a second, just so they don't scratch anything. Okay, so I can now do the same thing to the other side. So I want to get this lined up so that the edges, top edges, are as flush as they can be. And then I'll do exactly the same thing I did to the other side. So I'm just going to mark the holes. And then we can fix this side in now. Just reposition that and put the last three screws in. Okay, I think that's going to work quite well actually. So as I say, I'm just going to go and file the tips off these screws, and then just give that a sand just to get that nice and smooth, and then we'll see how this works. Obviously the same on both sides there, because those are just slightly poking out. Okay, that's filed and sanded smooth now, so they're not going to catch on me or any leather or anything else. Just looks like pinheads now. Okay, that's it, it's done. So what we'll do now is pull the camera back and we'll have a look at a couple of examples and see if it actually works. But I think in theory it should be okay, really. There's a little bit of slop in the hinge. It wasn't a very expensive hinge. It's like a, you know, just a 50p thing from the hardware shop. If this works okay, what I'll probably will do is remake this with a nicer piece of hardwood and get a better quality hinge, just so that it's, you know, less prototypey, and obviously put the leather round the right way on both sides. But I think as a proof of concept, it might work quite well. So let's have a look at some examples and see if it does what it's supposed to do. Alright, so I'm in the middle of stitching this bag, and as you can see at the moment, it's quite a large, unwieldy piece. And that in no way fits inside these jaws here, and it wouldn't really fit inside a clam either, because it's, you know, it's obviously very very long at the moment. So when I've stitched something like this in the past, what I've done is I've taken my pony, I've put the pony on the edge of the desk, like that, take a clamp, and I clamp the pony to the desk, like that, so that becomes fixed. Then what I've done is I've taken the bag and I've put the bag on the outside of the jaws folded like this, and then I've taken another clamp and I've clamped the bag like this into the side of the thing. And then what I've done is I'm stitching here, I shuffle it back, I'm stitching, I shuffle it back, so the jaw depth isn't then an issue. And the bag sits there, but obviously you're moving this a lot because you're only doing a little bit here, and also it's still quite floppy and stuff. So hopefully what we can try now is to use the new piece, see if that works well. So I'm going to leave this where it is here, because it's a long piece, it needs to drop down the front of the desk, and this would be something that I would stitch standing up, but I would have had to stitch that standing up anyway, really. So the idea then would be that this can be brought up here, in between these jaws. And there we go, that's worked quite well. I might need another clamp there, just to make sure that's nice and strong, so this doesn't drop as I'm stitching, or I'll use a stronger clamp there. But I think that works well, so it's now dropped down below the front of the table there, which means it's not folded, and I get a much longer run at the stitching, so I'm stopping and starting less all the time. I can get this threaded up, and I can stitch the majority of the length of the seam here. I've got this obviously to about the right height for me, as well. If you were taller or shorter and you were going to stand in this fashion stitching, you'd need to make sure that it was at a comfortable height, so you weren't hurting your back and you weren't trying to lean lean up too much. Okay, so I've now come to the end of my kind of jaw depth a little bit there. So as I say, what I can do now is I can just clamp this to the outside, and you could do this with any larger item that you wanted, really. You could just pop it on the outside, and that then gets around the problem with your jaws. Or you could make a bigger one, you know, whatever you want to do. And then you can see now that this part's resting on the table, obviously because we've come further back. This part's just extending beyond, and then I can just carry on and stitch this last little part. But you could use this technique for you know, any item that was too big to go in there, or if it's something that you couldn't clamp inside. So for example, you were doing a bag with a, you know, a gusset down the side, you could always clip that to the outside and stitch if you wanted, because that wouldn't go in between your jaws. So then this just becomes a support, really. So the next example I've got here is I've been making these kind of medicine pouches, which you know, fold up into a kind of pouch this way. And what we've got is we've got a thicker leather piece which adds the support and so on. And then the part of the bag that closes up and folds on itself is made out of quite a thin leather. And there's different leathers you can use for these. But what happens is, obviously we need to stitch this thicker piece to the thinner piece. So let's say we put that in a pony. You'll find that this piece here obviously just wants to flop down. So if you put your needle through, it's just flopped in the way. So you end up kind of like trying to flop it either from one side to the other like this. So every time your needle goes through, you flop it one way or the other. It takes you four times as long to sew it. Or what I do is I put it in the pony, and then I get a ruler. I put the ruler behind the piece like this, and that gives me like a vertical support, and then I clip it to the vertical support. But again, the problem with that is because the top of the pony is only, you know, like 2-3 inches, is that every time you do a couple of things, you have to take the ruler out, you have to move the thing down, clamp the ruler back in, adjust it so it's not too high, clip it to the thing again, and basically it ends up taking ages to stitch something like this because of all the fiddling about. So what this should also let me do is a similar thing. I can still support it with my little rulers, but because I've got this nice long depth, I don't have to then adjust it 50 times while I'm trying to do it there. So that would be an example of that. So rather than holding up one little bit of the floppy part, what I've got is I've got a little ruler at either end. I've lifted it up at both ends out of the way. That means I can get my hands front and back to do the saddle stitching, and then nothing's impeding on that at all. So the final example for today for this, because you don't need loads, I mean there's all different ways you could use it, but I just thought of a few, is when I'm making wallets, what happens is, because a wallet has a bend section, which means that you know, it opens out, a wallet doesn't really sit flat. You can see that if you open the wallet out, it sits kind of on an angle like that due to the different lengths of the pieces in there. So when you're stitching a wallet, you know, you stitch around the first section, and this piece isn't stitched, so it all, you know, it sits in the thing okay. Once you get round to stitching kind of the last part of the wallet, you know, as you're closing up the stitching, because it doesn't want to fold, it doesn't really sit in the clam. And what you have to do is you have to kind of bend the whole thing out of shape a little bit and then squash it in between the jaws. And I never like doing that because I don't, you know, it's upsetting the shape of what the wallet should be. So what you can do with this as well is, and I'm sat back down now, you know, this doesn't need to be a table thing, is I can sit with the pony between my legs where it normally would be. I can pop in the thing and then clamp that. And then what you could do is, if you imagine you were stitching the, you know, stitching around to the last section of the wallet, is that the wallet can then be placed in the jaws, and then that can be clamped there. So what we've got is the bottom part of the wallet here isn't squashed between any jaws, so it's free to just sit or hang in its natural shape without being squashed. The upper part of the wallet here, which is where we would be finishing the stitching as we come round, is nice and secure and can be stitched as normal just in front. So that's the final example there. Okay, so I hope you found that useful. If it's something that you think might help you with your projects, then feel free to give it a go. It's not going to take a long time to make, and I think you might find with, you know, certain projects, not with everything, that the time savings would be well worth, you know, spending half an hour making one of these. It's not obviously for everything. It's just, I think, for certain situations where it helps. Really a combination of, you know, a pony and or a clam and something like that would cover a lot of eventualities. But you're always going to get those certain items that are just really awkward to stitch due to the nature of them. Big bags and things, especially where you start to get parts flopping over other parts, is always going to be a bit difficult. But as I say, if you think that's going to help you, then give it a go. All right, see you next time.